Welcome to Pearisburg First United Methodist Church. I'm Brian Burks, the pastor of the church here, and it's a joy to meet you online. Why are we doing this online? It's because you matter. With the current coronavirus concerns in our community, we are practicing social distancing so that you don't get the virus as well. And that's why we're doing this week. And we praise God for the chance to meet you online and be a part of worship with us. Because you matter as well, we want to provide a place for you to grow spiritually the next couple weeks as well. And so one way we're helping you do that is through an online worship service. Today I pray that this service may bless you in some powerful ways, that you might experience the joy of Jesus and realize what God is calling us to be a holy people, people who walk in a straight line, people who follow Jesus. If this video helps you and helps, I encourage you to help somebody else this next couple weeks. Help them to grow spiritually as well during this two-week period. Help them by sharing this good news of Christ with them. If this video is helpful, share it with them as well. But I invite you to continue to use these 2 weeks to do something grand for Jesus. Amen.
The sheepskin. It doesn't mean much to us, but it meant something to our folks in our community years ago when they saw Robert Sheffey, the Methodist exhorter, pull this off his horse and go and unroll it. They knew that Robert Sheffey was about to do something grand. They knew that he was about to pray, and his prayers revolved around two things. The first one was he prayed for people to be set free from their sins. And he was specific about those sins. And in the midst of that, he prayed for their healing. But he also prayed for revival and renewal. The people of this community knew that when Robert Sheffey got down on his knees on that sheepskin, that people would be changed. Today, as we pray for the people of our community to be freed from the fears and the worries and the reality of the coronavirus, we pray that we may get back on our knees and see that happen once again. We pray as well that right now that God might come forth and do something new in our community and bring revival and set us free, ready to serve him once again. Would you pray with me today that God would do it again? Do it again, Lord. Do it again.
In the New Testament, there are 200 times it talks about the word righteous, a word that means simply walk straight in a line. Of those, 30% take place in the gospel and the letter to the Romans. I want to read you a few of those verses from chapter 3 of Romans, verses 21 through 26. Each time that word righteous appears, I encourage you to ask, what does it mean to walk straight in a line? But now, apart from the law, the righteousness of God has been made known, to which the law and the prophets testify. This righteousness is given through faith in Jesus Christ to all who believe. There is no difference between Jew and Gentile, for all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God, and all are justified freely by his grace through the redemption that came by Christ Jesus. God presented Christ as a sacrifice of atonement through the shedding of his blood to be received by faith. He did this to demonstrate his righteousness because in his forbearance he left the sins committed beforehand unpunished. He did demonstrate his righteousness at the present time, so as to be just and be the one that justifies those who have faith in Christ.
I may never climb a mountain so I can see the world from there. I may never ride the ocean waves and taste the salty air, or build a bridge that would last 100 years. But no matter where the road leads, one thing is always clear. We are blessed, we are blessed. For when we rise up in the morning, till we lay our heads to rest, I feel you near me. You soothe me when I'm weary. Oh Lord, for all the worst and all the best, we are blessed. All along the road that's traveled, I have crawled and I have run. I have wandered through the wind and rain until I found the sun. The watching eyes ask me why I walk this narrow way. I will gladly give the reason for the hope I have today. We are blessed, we are blessed. From when we rise up in the morning till we lay our heads to rest, I feel you near me. You soothe me when I'm weary. The worst and all the best, we are blessed. You've given me joy, you've given me love, you give me strength when I want to give up. You came from heaven to rescue my soul. This is the reason I know.
Worship. When you read about it in the Old Testament or in the New Testament, or it takes place even online, it always includes an offering. Can I suggest to you today 4 areas where you can make a difference through your offering? Because by the way, offering is a form of righteousness. It comes from that same Hebrew word. It means charity. First off, I'd like to suggest our Macy Backpack Ministry. It needs to continue. The good news is the Giles County School System has already put together a plan for meals for our children throughout the weekdays. Your donations make our weekend food ministry continue to low-income families. Teresa Fields, our director, was asked recently if we could expand the ministry to include the younger children involved with Head Start. Money is the only limiting factor for this, for what we can do. I also want to suggest a second one to our house. It's a multi-county ministry with the homeless who, like everyone else, has had to make major changes this week. We're taking our meal to them this Friday, March 20th in Christiansburg. Joanne Zimmerman is in charge of this and looks forward to your helping with it. Our Lenten offering for 2020 is divided between two needs. The Giles County Christian Service Mission experienced a giving miracle the last couple months. A dream to purchase the Brits Appliance Store was achieved this week, and we made the payment in cash. thanks to donations and grants. The donations were so generous, we were able to go ahead and authorize stage one of our 9-month renovation project and pay for the roof repairs. Bridge Appliance will continue to stay in business throughout 2020, and our next dream is to raise another $5,000 to provide modern heating and cooling for the building. Our final dream is to expand our food ministry to mission and training ministries so that these folks who come can be truly blessed. The other portion of the Lenten offering goes to our mission in Willow, Alaska. Currently, Alaska is covered in snow. Yet under those feet of snow remain signs of the wildfire from last August that destroyed over 50 buildings. This summer, we want to help that community rebuild. For information on how to give to these needs, check out our website or call the church office at 540-921-1021.
The term righteousness, as I said, appears 500 times in the Old Testament and 200 times in the New Testament. It is a term that describes what it means to walk in a straight line. It's a term that means to do the right thing. It's interesting, we toured Israel a couple weeks ago. We visited a community called the Qumran community. It really was a community pretty much unknown until 1947, when a little shepherd boy was up discovering some caves and went inside a cave looking for a sheep, and there inside the cave found a bunch of scrolls. The Qumran scrolls, the Dead Sea Scrolls, and probably what you remember the most as. There are 11 of those caves that have now been discovered, and they have found thousands of scrolls inside those caves. The interesting thing about those scrolls is about 40% of those are simply passages from the Old Testament that tell us what the Old Testament writings were. The other 60% though talk about the things the Qumran community believed and practiced and struggled about. They tell us about a community that was trying to live out a right relationship with God. A community that was saying, we want to be a holy people. We want to be set apart. We want to do the right thing. There's not much left among the rubble of that community anymore. There's some rocks that's been dug up quite a bit. A number of people have come through and excavated it and done archaeological digging. There's a watchtower, you can tell. There's a large dining hall area. There's a place where they found a bunch of ink wells and found, in fact, more ink wells there than anywhere else in all of Israel. But most of all, you can see there are places where water was collected on the hillside and taken by aqueduct down to the community and stored in cisterns. Lots of these. Now, obviously, if you live a mile from the Dead Sea, you want fresh water. It's an important thing to have. You want fresh water to drink. You want fresh water to cook with. But also, you want fresh water to do your work. And part of the work of the community apparently was making pottery. Among the things they found, when they did all the excavations, they found the scrolls, which were all contained in very specific pots, clay jars. They also found over 1,000 bowls and dishes, all stacked up neatly. Originally, someone said, well, they must have had a huge community here, but actually, the more people have researched, they decided this Qumran community had somewhere between 20 and 200 people who lived there, probably closer to the 20-person mark. 20 people do not need 1,000 bowls. Clay was used to sell to make an income. But the rest of the water, the real purpose they kept the water is for ritual bathing, the mitzvah. It's a Jewish bath. It's not like a bath you take every day when you jump in the shower and grab your shampoo. It's a bath where you would actually clean up beforehand and you would step down into the water, and it was actually measured out later to be 151 gallons was the goal of what each mitzvah was supposed to be.
And that 151 gallons was not to cleanse you, but to wash the dirt off. It was to do a transition from ritually unclean to ritually clean. There's lots of different ways those have been used since then. We have seen them in practice from the very 100 years before Christ until today. And in Jewish communities, whether you're Orthodox or conservative or Reformed, they have these same ritual baths in their synagogues today. And they are designed primarily at specific times in a person's life to say, I have been unclean and I want to be clean. Most Jews experience it at least twice in their life. Before you're on your wedding day, the bride and the groom would go to their respective place, to the men's and the women's, and they would take a ritual bath before their wedding day. Also, the day you die, your body would be placed in one of these and ritually cleansed as well. It was a declaration that said that you wanted to go from unclean to clean. It said, I wanted to go from unrighteous to righteous. It says, I want to be like God. I want to be someone who walks like God does. One of the things described righteousness is saying fair and unfair. And I realize that life is unfair. Recently, I went to a funeral for a lady who was 36 years old. On Tuesday, she went in for a normal hysterectomy surgery. On Friday, she died. She was pretty healthy. The family doesn't understand why. All they know is that she went in for a routine surgery and came out dead. Life can be unfair, tremendously unfair. But I want you to know something right now. In the midst of a world where we are scared, in the midst of a world where we wonder what's right, what's wrong, and all the fears that go with it, we have a God who is defined as a righteous God. And that means God is faithful. God is fair. He's just. And he does what he's supposed to do. We can trust God in that. He does the right thing. That's something you can take to the bank, and you don't have to be afraid of that. You know that we have a righteous God who walks a straight line. And the question for us is, are we willing to walk that straight line as well? Now, I ask you a question, though. How do you walk that straight line? In the Old Testament, there were all sorts of ways you could walk a straight line. In the coronavirus scare we're experiencing right now, and it's a pandemic, we know it is. We see the numbers from China, we see the numbers from Italy, we see the numbers of people here in Virginia and how that number continues to increase each day. And we're told to do simple things, wash your hands, wash them for 20 seconds. We're told to not touch your face. I like how one person put a cartoon up that had a dog collar, one of those dog things around their owner's face, and said, now don't touch your face anymore. Get it used to it in your head and be socially distant from other people. These are the things we do. But I also realize that in Old Testament, they came down to it and said, if we are going to be serious about being a righteous people, if we are going to take God's word and say, this is what really matters, then we need to take God's word seriously. And let's start with those Ten Commandments. Let's start with those Ten Commandments that speak to us and say, do not make a graven image. When you go into a Jewish synagogue, when you see the descriptions of the temple, you'll discover one intriguing thing. There's no images. There's no pictures of rabbis past. There's no picture of what God looks like. There's no animals etched into the designs. In fact, you find the same thing true when you go into a Muslim mosque. They simply say, we take the image of God and say that's nothing that we would like to do. And yet we go into our Christian churches, and to help people understand the past, to help them understand the present, we have pictures of Jesus. We have pictures of preachers who've come and gone. We have pictures of saints who've lived before us. And there is great value in that. But it raises the question, do we truly want to take the Word of God seriously? Do we want to be a righteous people? If we're going to take that one seriously, are we going to take the question about keeping the Sabbath holy? Are we going to take the question about honoring your father and mother? Are we going to keep the question about not telling any falsehoods in a world that's run by rumors and fear? By the way, if you want to know how much fear overcomes you, the only reason people are buying toilet paper right now is because they're scared. And fear has won. Righteousness in the Old Testament said God wins. Righteousness says we follow the law of God, and that's what we hang on to. That and nothing less. When my kids were little, we used to joke with them. They would do something that would make Mom and I rather upset. They had done something in our eyes that was wrong. And we simply said to them, I wonder, do you need to call your lawyer? Now, when we said that, what we meant was they knew they needed to call a grandparent or maybe their great-granddad. Because you know what? Those folks said our grandchildren are perfect. Our grandchildren do nothing wrong. They are perfect folks, and we believe in them every single step of the way. I think about those, and I think about God. God who comes to us and says, you know what? When it comes to Jesus comes along to us and says, it is by grace. It's a gift given to all people that you are forgiven, that you have been made righteous and holy in my image. Now, we struggle about that a little bit because first off, he says all who believe. And I know, do we really mean all? I mean, we like to define all as people who dress like us, people who talk like us, people who think like us and vote like us, or at least people who keep your yard mowed like we do. But Jesus says to us that anyone who believes, all who believe in Jesus' name, are declared righteous, as if they had no sin at all, as if they were at peace with God. They are declared that God loves them, that they are ones that God finds pleasure in. Today I ask us, at a time when we wonder about the future, we wonder the future is going to hold for us. And you say, preacher, why are you worried about righteousness right now? I am because the Bible also says to us, the prayer of a righteous man avails much. I'm concerned about righteousness because when you read the Gospel of Matthew, especially the Sermon on the Mount, Jesus says to us that our righteousness should exceed that of the Pharisees and the scribes. We read that blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness. Blessed are those who are persecuted for righteousness' sake. And I'm wondering, do we walk in a straight line? Do we please God? You know, if you get pulled over for drunk driving, one simple test is the police officer gets you out and says, can you walk in a straight line? I wonder how many of us, if God pulled us out right now, and pulled us out of our homes, and pulled us off our Netflix, pulled us off our computers, if we can walk a straight line before Jesus. If you can't, don't worry. God says to us, if you'll ask for forgiveness, I'll enable you to walk in a straight line again. And I'll hear your prayers. I'll hear your prayers as you're worried about the money, where it's going to come from these next 2 weeks. I hear your prayers as you're worried about, will this virus come to me? Will it come to my parents? Will it come to my grandparents? I'll hear your prayers as you wonder about your retirement funds and your future in our country. God says, I'll be there for you. Amen.
Many pastors started a sermon with the words, let the words of my mouth and meditation of my heart be acceptable in your sight, O Lord. I pray today with you right now that our words, our life, our actions, and our thoughts may be acceptable in the sight of God. They may be pleasing. They may be righteous. They may be straight paths that lead us towards holiness. They allow us to live life to the fullest and realize that we have a God we can trust in because he loves us. We set aside the fear. We set aside the concerns. And we look forward to the life that Christ has for us. Satan came to kill, steal, and destroy. The good news is Jesus came to bring life. And that's why we worship this day. And that's why we have hope. Amen.